share my story about how my life had affected my mental health and substance abuse. The situation I'm in is like 11 months old, so it's still very new. Kind of hard to talk about. But something that I feel like I need to do for myself and, you know, even for you guys out here so that I can help or save one person, and that kind of makes it all worth it. The story I'm going to tell you guys today is about my younger brother Bryce. So the story. So the story is about my younger brother Bryce. I was gonna do a little recap on us growing up together, and you know, all the stuff we did, and then I'm gonna kind of lead it into why I'm in front of you guys talking to you today. I'm the oldest of three brothers. Bryce was the middle child, and Dylan was the youngest. Bryce and I were really close growing up. We had, you know, we had the same sense of humor, and you know, we did our movie quotes, and you know, overused those, and drive our parents crazy, and you know, we made up a lot of funny songs about my dad. We used to pick on him a lot, and one time we sang "Happy Birthday" for a whole year, almost every day, to our younger brothers to annoy him. You know, stuff like that. We did, there's one thing we did that was, sorry, this is my third time doing this. I'm a little new. One time my brother, or my dad's friend, left his camcorder at our house, and we decided to take it and go around the neighborhood and film us doing silly things. You know, we filmed us skateboarding, and we made some smoke bombs of ping pong balls and stuff and put them in the tube slides at the playground by our house. And there was one time we snuck into my grandpa's house, and we went down to the basement and we hid. And we turned the TV on and cranked the volume, and we'd see him at the top of the stairs. We'd see a shadow, and we made him get up like three or four times before he finally came downstairs to see what was going on. And eventually he found us. And to this day, we still don't know why he said this, but he said, "If I ever catch you guys doing this again, I'm gonna throw dynamite at you." I have no idea. So we did stuff like that growing up. Everything Bryce got into, he was really good at. Like, I got into skateboarding, and he looked up to me and did it too. He was good at it. He was really good at, he played travel soccer for years. He was really good at that. He was forward, he scored all the goals. Cross country, track and field, I don't think there was ever a time he didn't come in first. He was probably one of the fastest people I ever met. Just before he got into grade 9, he got into playing guitar. And then when he got into grade 9, him and a few buddies started a band. They were fairly popular for the scene. You can tell there he had a good smile, so the ladies really loved him. But yeah, so shortly after the band broke up, we kind of noticed a change in him. He wasn't coming, like, he wasn't having dinner with us. He'd be out with his friends. He wouldn't come home during his curfew. And, you know, one day my mom found what no mom wants to find is a bag of weed in the room. So, you know, my mom asked him all the concerned mom questions, and he gave her the golden rule, "I'm holding it for somebody." So we gave the benefit of the doubt, right? He would, and we started noticing the pattern where we kept finding it in his room, and he kept coming home smelling like it, and, you know, all the telltale signs. And then one day he was brought home by the police. He was at a house party, and something had happened where the owner of the house or whatever wanted to press charges on him. And he ended up having to do a stint in New Beginnings and did a couple of other things. And once he got out of there, he kind of went right back to, you know, smoking marijuana and all the other stuff. And then it started getting worse. He started like naming times where, you know, our appliances would go missing, like weed whackers and stuff. We'd find them on Kijiji and stuff like that. And you know, what really kind of, I mean, that went on for a while. And then what really kind of was the last straw was around this time my grandfather had passed away, and him and my dad collected hockey cards their whole life. That was their big thing. And so he had a lot of rare and expensive ones. And after he had passed, my dad took those ones and put them in a safe at our place. And one day my dad went in there and all the cards were gone. Bryce had taken them out and sold them to pawn shops for next to nothing, just so he could keep buying his marijuana. That was the first time I saw my dad show any emotion. You know, most dads are kind of the rock in the family, and you know, they don't show too much to the strong, tough guy. But when I saw him beat up about that, I knew that was a really big deal. And that kind of forced the family to make a decision on what we needed to do with him, with Bryce. And we sat down with him and we told him, listen, you know, we gotta, like, end this. You know, we can help you, but, you know, you gotta get your crap together. And, you know, or you have to go to grandma's. And my grandma lived like a 2-minute walk. It was just around the corner. And he said, you know, he got up and he said, you know, I don't need you guys. And he left. He packed his bags and he left. And that was just after his 16th birthday. And that's where he spent the last 9 years, is in the basement of my grandma's. And he converted the garage into a party pad. And the first 6 years, he really had a lot of people over. You know, his friends would bring friends of friends, and it was really hard on my grandma. They were really disrespectful to her house. He started taking money from her. He started taking her medication. There was times when my parents would go over there to check up on him, like in the morning, and he'd be, like, the car would be still running in the driveway. He'd be half hanging out of it, you know, passed out. And there was one time he even flipped the car 3 times in an oncoming traffic light van. Well, and everyone at the scene thought there was no survivors because the car was so totaled. But luckily for him and his two friends that were with him, they came out barely with any scratches. So yeah, there was a lot of, so it was really hard for the first few years. And the first few years also, I've had a lot of resentment towards him, because myself, I've never drank or done any drugs or smoked in my life. So when I saw him hurting the family when he was on that stuff, it really bothered me. So I kind of didn't, you know, go out of my way to talk to him or nothing for the first couple of years. But eventually I kind of pushed it aside and said, you know, Indiana is my brother, and I don't agree with what he's doing, but, you know, we kind of went back to our civil ways anyways, and, you know, we were close and joked around again. The last 3 years or so, he started coming around more often, especially to my parents' house. He'd do a lot of the lawn work and yard work and stuff and help him around the house. You know, my parents paid him because he couldn't keep a job. He'd always be too drunk, or he'd rather party with his friends, or he'd be too hungover. And, you know, so they pay him. And this is the same time where we started noticing that his drinking went really kind of wild. You know, he'd drink like a case a day, basically the blackout almost every day. And we started hearing rumors that he was, you know, getting into cocaine, which at the time he denied when we asked him. The last year or so, he was in a really toxic relationship, put the whole family in a, you know, a lot of pain, but it was really hard for him. You know, there was restraining orders and court dates, and he even did a little time in jail because of her. And around this time too, all of his friends kind of disappeared. They all bettered themselves. They all kind of went on to, you know, a lot of them got married. Some of them had kids. They were moving out west and getting good jobs. They're all kind of bettering themselves. And at the same time, around the same time, our youngest brother went over to Kitchener, because he went to school, and he got a good job there, and then he ended up getting engaged over there too. So everyone around him was kind of just better themselves, and he was still stuck in this rut. And I think it was kind of like an eye-opener for him. And last summer, on June 18th, which was Father's Day, Bryce and my dad had plans to build the backdrop for our youngest brother's wedding. He was scheduled to get married the following weekend. So my mom went over there around 12-ish, and to tell him, it's Father's Day, go hang with your dad, and help him build the backdrop. And he was already in the bag pretty well. And he had some friends over, and they were already partying that early. And he said, yeah, I'll be there, don't worry about it. And then, my mom went out and did her errands for the day, and on the way home, because my grandma lives so close, she just kind of scooted around to her place to see where, what he's up to and if he was coming over. And this was around 3 o'clock or so, just after three. And so she pulled up and went into the garage, and she noticed him laying on the couch, and so she walked over up to him, and it was the middle of the summer, so it was really hot. So she shook him, and he kind of grunted, and she said, "Listen, go inside where it's cool. Get some rest. Come over for dinner. We'll make you something, and then you can help your dad." And he kind of grunted, "Yeah, okay, no problem. I'm fine." So she left, and then. Then about 6 o'clock or so rolled around, and she, my mom was like, "Okay, what the heck? Like, where is he?" And so she got back in the car and scooted over to my grandma's house again, and walked up to the garage and to the side door of the garage, and this time noticed him on the floor. And there's a lot of times we found him passed out on the floor, or passed on the couch, fell off onto the floor. So. She walked up to him to go wake him up, and she crouched down and grabbed his arm, and he was ice cold. My brother had hung himself, and cord broke, and that's why he was on the ground. And that's I think that's something that any parent thinks they're going to go through, shouldn't go through, probably thinks that's something that will never happen to them. I couldn't imagine being a parent and finding your son in that state. Shortly after his passing, we kind of talked to a lot of people and did some research, and we realized that his excessive drinking was a coping mechanism to kind of get him through the days. And technically, that was the only sign he had. Otherwise, he was the life of the party. He was always laughing. We were always joking. We would have never guessed. We knew the drinking was bad. We didn't know this bad, but we didn't know the severity of it. For Bryce, he was really closed up. He never really let anybody in. We kind of noticed that after he had passed. I sat the family down, and I was kind of the first to notice, and I said to my family, I said, "Listen, what do we really know about Bryce?" And they all were kind of blown away. We would know the exact same thing as a dating profile would have provided. He loved to fish, sports teams, favorite food, stuff like that. I even sat one of his friends down that he's been best friends and hung out with almost every day. 10 years, and he said the same thing. I just didn't notice. I didn't even notice that he was so shelled up. Like, he never let anybody in. And, I think that the last few years of, ever since he left the house, it was kind of rough for him. The last few years were exceptionally rough, with the toxic relationship and everyone moving on, bettering themselves, and, the excessive drinking. And, that day he passed, they did find cocaine in his system, and I found out later, we all found out that the last few years he had been using it regularly. But I think the accumulation of all that kind of lined up for him, and gave him really thoughts, really intense thoughts of suicide, and in that moment he acted on it. It's really affected my life, mainly for the worst. Just some good, like, you know, choosing to talk about it in front of people, you know. And, you know, on Facebook, I do a lot of sharing on suicide prevention and awareness and stuff, and I really share how I'm going through the pain and you know, the daily struggles, just so people know that this is, you know, when you leave everything behind, it really, you know, it doesn't end for everybody else. And, yeah, but the bad really outweighs the good. I find it hard to, you know, leave the house. I haven't hung out with any of my friends since then. I quit one of my jobs. I don't really work the other one. You know, the golden question with suicide is why? You know, why did he do it? Why didn't we see anything? Why did he ask for help? It's a question that's never left my head since June 18th. It's really a nightmare that I can't wake up from. I find the word pain doesn't really do justice. You know, after I found that he had passed, that was the moment I finally knew the definition of heartbreak. Because when he said that he had died, I felt my heart breaking in my chest. And it's something that you'll never understand unless you live it yourself. I just want to end this speech with, if you yourself or you know anybody who's struggling with depression or substance abuse, or if you guys have kids at home and you kind of see some similarities with my brother's story, I'm just saying, like, be aware of it. You know, don't feel like a lot of people push it aside and say, that won't happen to me. But, you know, look at my family. And, you know, I just want to say there's a lot of help out there. The Canadian Mental Health Association is great, and there's crisis lines to call and a number you can text if you're not comfortable talking over the phone. They say on average there's about 115 people affected by one person's suicide, and that's a pretty big number. I can guarantee you at least one, if not more, of those people will help you. So I wouldn't wish the pain that I feel on anybody in this room. And I just want to say thanks for listening. And if you guys have any questions or want to talk, I'll be here to the end, in the hallway or whatever. So I'll say thanks for listening.